Now we are going to discuss another tumor of the cervix, which is adenocarcinoma of the cervix. But before going into the invasive adenocarcinoma of the cervix, we must know a little bit of adenocarcinoma in situ. This adenocarcinoma in situ is seen in women in the third and fourth decade of life, usually without symptoms. Sometimes they are diagnosed incidentally during workup of abnormal Papanicolaou or Pap test for cervical dysplasias. Its incidence is increasing due to improved detection of this tumor in Pap smears, because collection with current endocervical brush improves the yield of cells which are required for the diagnosis. It is associated with human papillomavirus infection. The associated risk factors include obesity, hypertension, and use of oral contraceptives which contain content of progesterone. Around 50% of cases are associated with cervical intraepithelial neoplasia and invasive squamous cell carcinoma of the cervix. Gross appearances, it is usually above the squamocolumnar junction. It is often multifocal. It is rarely seen on colposcopic examination. Microscopic features, the glands are normally present with malignant epithelial cells lining. There is high nuclear cytoplasmic ratio. The nuclear chromatin is irregular and inconspicuous nucleoli. There is cellular stratification. There is increased mitotic activity. The most common types are endocervical, followed by intestinal type and endometrioid type. There is absent desmoplastic reaction. Now, this is the photograph which shows microscopic appearances of adenocarcinoma of cervix, which is in situ. Now, you can well appreciate the glands are lying back to back against each other, and they show stratification of the cells. Most of the cells are pleomorphic. All these features are indicated by red arrows. Immunohistochemistry, CEA is usually positive, vimentin is negative, mucin is positive. Now we are coming to our main topic, which is adenocarcinoma of the cervix. Of course, the invasive type. Its incidence is increasing. They are mostly seen at the age of 40 to 50 years, little older as compared to squamous cell carcinoma. There is an association with human papilloma virus. The risk factors include obesity, hypertension, oral contraceptive pills containing contents of progesterone. Around 40% of cases are associated with squamous intraepithelial lesion and invasive squamous cell carcinoma of the cervix. It may present with a watery discharge. Gross features, they are generally exophytic, polypoidal, nodular, or papillary lesions. Histological features, there are variable combinations of cell types. Mucinous endocervical type, it resembles normal endocervical epithelium. Rarely, papillary formation can also be seen. Mucinous intestinal type, there is a pseudo-stratified columnar epithelium with goblet cells. Now, this photograph shows microscopic features of adenocarcinoma of the cervix. You can well appreciate that the glands are lying back to back against each other and are lined by pleomorphic cells having hyperchromatic nuclei and many foci. The endocervical glands, which are lined by pleomorphic cells, and they are lying back to back against each other, and at many foci they are infiltrating the cervical stroma. Then there is another type, which is mucinous intestinal type. This is characterized by pseudo-stratified columnar epithelium with goblet cells. Now, in this photograph, you can appreciate pools of mucins, and there are endocervical cells which are present in the form of glands. The pool of mucins, they are shown by red arrow, whereas poorly formed endocervical glands or pleomorphic cells which are of intestinal type are present in the pool of mucin. They are shown by the black circle. Now, other subtype, mucinous signet ring cell type, the nuclei are pushed to the periphery with abundant intracytoplasmic mucin. Now, this photograph shows that signet ring cells are marked with red arrow, whereas black rectangle shows large number of cells which are present in groups and showing the features of signet ring. The other subtype is endometrioid type. There is stratified epithelial cells with minimal granular cytoplasm and resemble like malignant endometrial glands. Intracytoplasmic mucin is absent. Now, this is the photograph which shows endometrioid type of adenocarcinoma of the cervix. You can well appreciate that in this photograph, the glands have the resemblance of endometrium and they are lying back to back against each other. Now, there is another subtype known as minimum deviation adenocarcinoma, also called adenoma malignum. Cytologically, the glands are bland and mucinous endocervical type. There are irregular branching glands which are of variable sizes. There is increased number of glands at the surface and extending deep in the wall of the cervix, which is greater than 5 mm. The stroma shows desmoplastic reaction. Cervical biopsy may not be deep to establish the diagnosis. Now, another subtype, which is called well-differentiated papillary willow glandular type. Patients are generally in the third and fourth decade of life. This tumor may be deeply invasive. There is a complex branching papillary pattern. The lining is of endocervical, endometrioid or intestinal type, which shows stratification. The cytological atypia is minimal. The mucin is also minimal. There is another subtype which is called clear cell adenocarcinoma. It is mostly associated with stilbestrol therapy. Most of the patterns are tubulocystic and solid. However, papillary, tubular and tubercular pattern are also present. These tumor cells are polyhedral in shape with rounded atypical nuclei and clear cytoplasm containing glycogen. The hobnail cell is characteristic finding in which the nucleus protrudes beyond the boundaries of the cell into the lumen, tubular or cystic spaces. Sometimes the epithelial cells are flattened, cuboidal, oxyphilic or signet ring type. Somoma bodies or intracellular hyaline bodies may also be seen. Now, adenocarcinoma with features of carcinoid tumor. Occasionally, an adenocarcinoma of cervix may contain areas of endocrine carcinoma which are positive for neuroendocrine markers. Paraendocrine syndromes are rare. They are not responsive to the usual treatment. Grading of the adenocarcinoma of the cervix, well differentiated, one can appreciate more than 50% of the glands. Moderately differentiated, when 50% of glands are present. Poorly differentiated, when less than 10% glands are recognized. Depth of invasion is measured from the cervix. Immunohistochemistry, CEA usually positive in mucinous adenocarcinomas and negative in normal endocervical glands. Other techniques, HPV often detected by PCR or in situ hybridization. Treatment is radical mastectomy with pelvic lymphadenectomy. Radiation therapy is preferred for the tumors that are larger than 5 cm at the time of diagnosis. Tumor smaller than 1 cm do not give metastasis to lymph nodes. Prognosis depends on the stage of the tumor.